Hello, fellow Unreal Engine developers. I hear a lot of people saying that with Epic's free water plugin, you can't add oceans to existing landscapes. Well, I'm here to say that it is easier than you think to do that, and you can adjust the height of the ocean on those landscapes. So I'm going to show you how to do it for small landscapes, larger 8K landscapes, and even world partition landscapes. So let's get straight into it. Let's start off with a smaller landscape. So if I look at the one in this project, you can see that it is 2K by 2K. And what we'll do is we will add an ocean to this landscape first, and then I'll show you the extra steps you need to do for larger landscapes and world partition landscapes. So the first thing you need to do is to enable the water plugin. So go to Edit, Plugins, search for water, and check the box here. I've already got it set up for this project. You'll get a message saying, it's experimental, do you sure you want to use it? Say yes, and then you'll get a restart now. So click that, and I'll be here when you've restarted. Okay, so you've restarted your project. Nothing's changed at the moment, but we now have the elements to add our ocean. So let's go, first of all, to, this is a very important point. Your landscape must be in enabled layers mode. So with your landscape selected, go to the details panel and search for layer. And you find this enable edit layers. If yours is already checked, you're good to go. But if not, click on that. It says, are you sure you want to do it? Say yes. And after a second or two, depending on your processor, it will say that it's ready. If it doesn't say anything, it's probably just happened straight away. What you'll now be able to do is add the water system on top of this. So let's go into the add menu here, all classes, and then if you drag the scroll bar down, this is alphabetical, down to the bottom, we have all of these water elements. So let's drag our water body ocean into the landscape, but this is the first important tip. So I'm dragging this in, I haven't let go of it yet. What I want you to do is I want you to find the highest peak on the landscape. It doesn't have to be exact. So I'm going to use this one here and drop it down there. And I'll tell you why we're doing that in a second. But for now, this is what I guess most of you have seen when you've tried this. It's got this little round island, but none of the existing landscape is showing. And the reason for that is because the way that it's blending this island with the landscape is set up incorrectly for what we want to do. So in order to fix that, let's come to our water here. So we've got it selected, water body ocean in the outliner. Make sure your search box is cleared because it might still say layer. And come down here to the terrain section. So if it's closed, open it up, and also open up the water height map settings beneath it. And you'll see at the moment the blend mode is set to alpha blend. What we want to do is we want to change that to max so that it is the water system is allowing the maximum of the two layers height maps to show through. So if I click that, after a couple of seconds, you'll see the tips of the mountains poking through. And the reason we're only seeing the top of these is because we placed the water island right at the top of the landscape. So that's fine. But we should now be able to adjust the height of this water body and see the rest of the land. So let us go to back up to the top. And the location at the moment, yours will probably be slightly different, but because I placed mine right at the top, it's at a very high elevation, 10,700 on mine. Let's try reducing that by half. Let's put it at 5,000. And now we can see more islands appearing here. And if I reduce it further to zero, we can see even more of our landscape appearing. And finally, let's make this negative, minus 5,000. And now this looks like a whole continent with a few lakes inside surrounded by a vast ocean. So we've been able to get the ocean working inside our existing landscape without an issue. Now let me address why we put the water body on top of the highest peak. So the reason why I did that is if I go back to the water body and let's put the location back up to 5,000. So this is where we had a few islands around, and what you'll notice is that our original water body spline is spilling out into the surrounding landscape and creating this round area and this dip here, which we don't really want. So you might think you could just get rid of this spline. So let's try changing the scale to zero. So if I put zero in here, it's got rid of the problem here, but there's a bit of a bug up in the right hand corner. You can see here one of our C components is missing, so that's not going to work. However, what we can do is make this very small. So let's make this 0.1 on the x-axis and also 0.1 on the y-axis. And you'll see now that because it's so small, it has no effect on the landscape around it. And this is why I put this on the highest peak, because as we reduce the size of the height of the ocean, you'll see that that's always going to be beneath the highest point and have no effect on our existing land. So if you haven't put it in the right place, you can move it around afterwards. So it's not an issue you have to worry about. You can move it later, but it's a good habit to get into putting it on the highest point to start off with. So let's leave it at this zero section here. And what I want to talk about next is I want to talk about the three assets associated with the ocean that change the look and feel of the material and the waves. So at the moment, the default is this sort of milky light blue. But let's say we wanted a different color ocean with more transparency. How would we do that? So let's start off by looking at the main central ocean material. If you select the water body, and if you scroll down to near the bottom, you'll find this section here called rendering. And within here, you have two materials, one for the main water and one for the underwater effect. So the water material here is called water material ocean. And we need to make sure in your project, if you haven't got it set already, that you can see plug-in and engine content. So let's just do that first. So with the main viewport selected, go into the content browser by pressing Control Space, and in the settings, make sure that you've got Show Engine Content and Show Plugin Content checked, so that we can see the materials that come with the plugin. Okay. And now with this back on this water body, water material, click on here to browse to it, and we will find it, and you can see it's in a folder, plugins, water materials here. Now we don't want to change this material because it will affect the plugin in all projects. So what we will do is we'll copy this. So take this, scroll this up to the top so you can see your top level content folder, and drag the water material ocean into your top level content folder, and make sure you copy, don't move. If you move it, then it won't be in the plugin folder anymore. So copy it. And while we're here, this is the material for the main ocean. The ocean beyond these boundaries is controlled, the material is controlled by this water far mesh. So let's select that one and also drag that to content and copy it. Okay. So now in our top level content folder, we have two new materials. Let's rename them. So select it, F2, and I'm just going to put tutorial on the end of the name, and the same with the water material ocean, F2, and I will just put tutorial at the end. So we now have two new materials, water material ocean tutorial and water farmish tutorial with an H, extra H on them. Let me just clear that up. Right, so now we need to assign these new custom materials to our ocean components. So let's go to our water body ocean, water material ocean, and let's change that to water material ocean tutorial. So no change because we copied it. And similarly, let's go to the water zone, which is responsible for the far mesh or the far boundary of the ocean. And if you scroll down till you find the mesh section, open up this far distance section, and you've got a material here, which at the moment is water far mesh, and we'll replace that with water far mesh tutorial. Again, you won't see the change. So this is probably a good time to do a save. Let's click save here, save the project. And now let's start changing the water materials to see what we can affect. So let's open up our content folder and let's open up the water material ocean tutorial. And actually while we're here, let's go in there and open up the water far mesh tutorial as well. So we've got both. Let's just move them across slightly so we can see the viewport, and we can probably make that slightly smaller as well. Okay, so let's start off. So you've now got both of the materials up here. Let's start off with the, or material instances, I should say. Let's start off with the water material ocean tutorial. There are lots of settings here. If you want to see some tweaks for things like the sort of the look of the water close up, and foam and things like that, check out in my channel the last video I did on my tropical island final tweaks, and you can see various values I changed then. But for today, I'm just going to concentrate on the basic color and opacity. So if I go down until I find the section called global vector parameter values, and I'll just show you what you might see here, I want to look at absorption and scattering. So let's select both of those and expand them. And scattering is to do really with the transparency of light in the water, and absorption is really to do with the color of light in the water, and they play off each other. So let's start off with the scattering. If I reduce the, I'm only going to change the alpha value, I'm not going to change any of the colors, just the values. So with scattering, if I change the alpha value to 0, what that does is it makes it transparent. So let's go closer so we can see. You can see now that a bit like a sort of a Mediterranean ocean, you can see the material underneath the surface, whereas before we couldn't see anything underneath the surface. And similarly, if we change the alpha of the absorption, so if we increase the alpha, then it's making the color lighter. So now not only can we see under the water, we can actually see the seabed as well. So there are, it's looking nice, but there are two issues with doing these sort of changes that we need to be aware of. The first issue is that if we go up a bit, okay, so if I look out towards the horizon, you can see that the water beyond the boundary is a different color because we haven't changed that material yet. So let's fix that issue first. We've got our water material ocean sorted. Now let's select the water far mesh tutorial. This is responsible for the water beyond the boundaries, and we'll just change it to match. So let's come down to these absorption and scattering parameters in our far mesh tutorial and set them to the same. So the alpha here was 16 and the alpha of the scattering was 0. And now our water color and opacity matches over in the distance. So that was the first issue. The second issue, which you'll see if I look down, is that we can now see the end of the landscape. So even though we've created a nice landscape with smooth edges, we can still see where the end of the world is. So to fix that, we have a couple of ways of going about it. One of them is just to adjust our alphas until those are hidden. So for example, and again they play off each other. So if I reduce this to 8, well, at the moment that's not going to have any effect because it's completely transparent, but let's say I'll put this up to 0.02, and then if I reduce this to 4, oh, I'm doing it on the far mesh. So sorry, let me put that back to 16 and 0. Let's go to the right material, the water material ocean for here. Now, if I put up the alpha here to just something like 0.02, you can see it's smoothed that edge a bit. And now if I reduce the alpha here to 8, we're starting to blur the edge. But we don't have the same transparency that we had before. So it's not quite the effect. If I want to have the same transparency but still not see the edge, there's another approach I can adopt. So let's put these back to what they were, 16 and 0. And the other thing we can do is we can reduce the height of the seabed. So to do that, let's save these. And we probably don't need these showing anymore, so let's just shut those down. So select your water body ocean, and in the details panel, if you go to near the top, there's a section on terrain and beneath that curve settings. And you'll see here one of the parameters is channel depth, which defaults to 2000. But let's make this 8000. And you'll see that our seabed has reduced in size and is virtually invisible. It's barely visible, and we could tweak the settings for the alpha, but we probably don't need to because we're not going to be at this height. But you can see now that we've got this lovely fall off of our island. So there's that real sense of depth in the ocean. We can see down the slope, but we can't see right to the seabed. We can barely see the seabed. So those are the sort of two material settings. And I said there were three settings we could change. The third one is to do with the way the waves show, especially when you're close up. So let's go into play mode. And let's try and get to the ocean. In fact, what I will do is I will probably raise the ocean up so that we don't have to run as far to see what it looks like. So let's go back to our water body and make the location 5000. Okay, and you can see now the water is further up. We have more islands. And the first thing I want to do is just look at the, let's just reduce our camera speed down to 4, and I'll come down a bit. So I'm using W, A, S, and D to move around and Q and E to go up and down. And let's just go down to near the water surface, just so we can see the waves here. And you can see the waves are quite strong here at the moment. Again, it's down to personal taste what you want, but you've got total control over these wave patterns. So to change them, we need to go back to our water body, and near the top, there is a section called wave. And within that, you'll find a wave source and a wave asset. So with the ocean by default, it uses this Gerstner waves ocean setting. And just like the materials, we don't want to change this. We want to create a copy of it. So browse to it. And just like we did with our materials, let's drag this Gerstner Waves Ocean to our top level content folder, copy it. Okay, and now you can see we've got this new waves asset at the top level. Let's rename that and append tutorial on the end. And let's make sure that this is now assigned to our ocean. So with our water body ocean selected. Now select Gerson the Waves Ocean Tutorial. There shouldn't be any change. And if you now open this up, we can change some of the parameters here. So again, it's down to taste, but if we want to reduce the sort of violence of these waves or the number of them, we can change the number of waves to 5. So again, well, straight away, that's made it a calmer ocean. This randomness here means that the waves don't all start in the same place. So that's a nice feature to put on. Wavelength is the distance between the peaks of the waves here. So if we reduce the wavelength, things get closer together or further apart. So we can make them slightly further apart. We can then change the amplitude of the waves. So that's how high the peaks go up and down in the ocean. So let's make that smaller on the minimum and smaller on the maximum. So let's make that 6. And then final thing I'm going to show you here is the wind direction. So at the moment, the dominant wind direction is the bearing from which the wind comes. And then the angular spread is how much randomness the wind moves around in space. So we'll keep the angle at 0. The wind angle is largely arbitrary anyway, but I'll just limit the angular spread to 90. And now you're seeing that waves are going primarily in one direction with a slight spread of 90 degrees. So you can see this is a much calmer looking ocean here now, but we still have our great look from above with the color and transparency. So one last thing I want to show you before we move on to the larger landscape. If I go into, let's save this, close it down, let's do a quick save of our level. And I want to show you one last thing you get with the ocean plugin. If I go into play mode, and let's go down to the water level. And you can see even from the player's perspective, that transparency of the water is visible from the way I set up the material. But once I get to the water level, if I go under the water, you can see that the underwater post-process material kicks in and we get this foggy effect of, and slight blue tint of being underwater. So that is assigned as part of the water body ocean as well. So it automatically detects when you're above water and beneath water in order to switch those effects. So we've set up this water as far as the eye can see, and we can set it up at any height on this landscape. Now, if you want to do this for the larger landscapes, there are two extra steps you need to do. So let's cover those now. So in this level, I've loaded up a larger landscape. If I click on the landscape, you can see that this is 8K by 8K. And if there's any stuttering in this section of the tutorial, I apologize, but the larger landscape consumes more resources, especially when I change parameters. So hopefully it'll be okay, but just be aware of that. So I've done everything in here the same as the smaller landscape in setting up the ocean and changing the parameters. But for this large landscape, there are two extra things you need to change to make sure everything works properly. And the first one I've made obvious by changing the color of the material for the far ocean. So you can see that the center ocean doesn't cover the boundaries of the landscape. So I've made the outer ocean material the lighter color. So that's the first thing we need to change for large landscapes. Unfortunately, there's one parameter that controls this. So go to your water body ocean as before, and go to the water zone, not the water body ocean. The water zone controls the tiling of the overall mesh. And then in the detail panel, come all the way down to near the bottom until you find the mesh section, and you will see this parameter tile size. So this defaults to 2400, which was fine for our 2K landscape, but it's not big enough for our 8K landscape. So if we change this, let's just double it, 4800, you can see that our center material expands. Still not big enough, so let's make it 6400, and now it encompasses the whole of the landscape. So let's just now change our far material in the zone to match the center material. So I'm already in the water zone, and just beneath this tile size is the far distance section, which has the mesh. So if I change this to a mesh with the material on, you can see that now my ocean is the same across the whole of the horizon. So if I drill down here, you can see that as far as the eye can see, it's the same ocean material. So that's great. So that was the first thing you need to change for larger landscapes. You need to increase that tile size in order to encapsulate the larger landscape area. The second problem you run into, which again has got a quick fix, is if I go into play mode and let's go down to the water. And this error you're seeing at the top, I'll show you how to get over that in a minute as well. It's not really to do with this ocean tutorial, but it's something you might find useful to know. If I go under the water, you can see that I have no underwater post-process material at all. So we need to fix that. The reason for that is because it sets some boundaries for the underwater post-process volume as well. So we need to expand that in addition to the changing the tile size. So let's come out of play mode. And now if you go to the water body ocean, and if you search within the details panel for collision, the first set of parameters you'll find here are called collision extents. And by default, they're set to 50,000 by 50,000 on the X and Y axis. That's not big enough for our 8K landscape. So let's change that to 500,000. And this is where it does some recalculations, so it might stutter. And I'll change the other one to 500,000 as well. And after about 5 seconds, it's recalculated everything. Hopefully there wasn't any corruption on the recording. Let's go into play mode. And now if we go into our water, we now have our underwater post-process effect back because it's the volume encompasses this area. So those are the only two things you have to do for this large landscape. I'm just going to show you this texture streaming issue we've got. It's not really to do with this ocean tutorial as much, but while I'm here, let me just quickly show you this as an added bonus tip. If I go to my console command down here, and if I do stat streaming, you can see that the required pool is way over the memory I've given. So the memory I've assigned to here is 1000 megabytes or 1 gigabyte, which is the default, but it's going over that pool size. But we can change the pool size. I've got a 3080, so I've got a good amount of memory in there. I think it's 10 gig, if not 12, can't remember. So what we can do is here, we can do R dot, yeah, this is the one you want. So it's R dot streaming dot pool size. And then after a space, I'm going to set it to 4000 or 4 gigabytes. And if I do that, then immediately all of my memories are within way under the 100% of the pool. I don't know if you noticed, but immediately my textures improved on the landscape because it was having to reduce the MIPS in order to, and reducing the quality of the textures. So now if I switch off that streaming, stat streaming, go into play mode, hopefully you'll see that my materials here are a little bit more detailed than they were before. So not strictly necessary for this tutorial, but a little aside that's worth noticing or worth noting when you're dealing with large landscape sizes. So we've dealt with small landscapes, we've dealt with large landscapes. Let's move on finally to talk about world partition landscapes, because there's one extra parameter you need to set for those landscape types. I've loaded the default open world map in Unreal Engine, which uses world partition landscapes, just to show you this last tweak we need to do. So I've done everything exactly as we did in the previous two sections. I've dragged in my water body ocean and set everything up the way we did before. Before I show you the setting that we need to change, I just want to show you something that might happen with your landscapes. Doesn't matter whether they're world partition or regular landscapes, just something to be aware of. So if I switch on this water, can you see that there are sections here where it's not showing the water material at all? And this is just something to be aware of in general. You can probably see why. When the landscape ends, it's ending at an elevated level, and that's above the level we've set the sea to. So any space where there are holes at the end of the landscape, it's not able to extend the sea out from that point. The way to solve this problem is simply to go into sculpt mode and smooth the edges. Or if you're creating the terrain outside of Unreal Engine, just make sure you feather the edges to a flat level at the end. For now, just so we can get on with the tutorial, what I'll do is I'll select my water zone, go to the details panel, and I'll just reduce the tile size to bring that ocean in. So under the mesh section, we had the tile size. It's 2400 by default. Let's make it 1500. And that just brings in my central ocean within that landscape area. And the far mesh is not affected by the landscape, so that's fine. Okay, so let's go into play mode and see what it looks like. So I turn around and I look, and the ocean's there, and everything looks good. So everything's working exactly the same as with other landscapes. Now, the thing with world partition landscapes is you can set the loading distance for your components or the grid elements. So let's just do that and see what effect that has on the ocean. So if we go to our world settings here, if you don't see world settings, just go to window world settings and check that. So once you've got your world settings window showing, go down to the section on world partition. It's after physics, and you'll find this section. You might have to expand it, runtime settings, grids with various indexes. So open everything up. And if you're using the default one like me, you'll see that there is a single grid here with a loading range of 76,800. So this is the distance at which it's going to load cells in front of the camera. So let's imagine that we don't want to load cells far away. So I'm going to reduce this from 76,800 to 76,80. So it won't load so far away. And if I now click save and go into play mode, once I turn around and look at my landscape, the ocean has disappeared. And the reason for that is because the ocean location is not within that distance, that streaming distance. Now, clearly, we don't want the ocean to pop in and out of existence. And luckily, there is a way of ensuring that it always shows on the screen during play. So let's set that. Come out of play mode. And what we'll do now is go back to our details panel, select our water body ocean, and search here for spatial. And you'll find here there is a world partition section for every actor. So as you add things into your scene, by default, this world partition is spatially loaded parameter will be set, will be checked on. What that means is those elements will be loaded in and out depending on the distance setting, the loading distance setting. As we don't want this to happen with our C, let's uncheck this, meaning that it will always be loaded regardless of what we set in the load distance. And that's all we have to do. So click save, and now if we go into play mode, you can see that our ocean is there even with the restricted loading distance. So that's the only thing you need to do for world partition landscapes, is set the spatially loaded, or uncheck the spatially loaded flag on the ocean. Other than that, everything else is the same. So I hope you found today's tutorial useful. Stay subscribed for more tutorials coming in the future, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye for now.